So what I'm going to do today is kind of a cross between two of my favorite subjects, which are Parsha and Geula and Mashiach, Mashiach and Redemption. It's not this week's Parsha. We're going to be talking about focusing on last week's Parsha. It says in the Zohar about Shabbos, Minei Mizbarchim Kol HaYomim, that all the days of the week are blessed from the Shabbos, which actually refers to the Shabbos, the week following the Shabbos. So Shabbos has a connection both to the week before, because that's when we read the Torah portion that we prepared for and read during the days leading up to it. It also gives blessing to the days following it. So what I want to do is talk about something, and this is really an extremely important and very powerful lesson that we can take away from last week. And that's not just from the Parsha per se, it's a little more than that. Because if any of you were in Shul on Shabbos, you probably noticed that after Kriyas HaTorah was finished, after they finished reading the Torah portion, everyone called out Chazak, Chazak, V'nischazek. Chazak means strong, saying strong, strong, V'nischazek, and let us strengthen ourselves. Right? Did I translate Nischazek correctly? Israelis in the room? Yeah? Awesome.
Make stronger.
So, 1 second. So the origin of this minhag, there's a minhag that we have that after each of the Chamisha Chumshei Torah, after each of the five books of the Torah, Bereishis, Shmos, Vayikra, Bamidbar, Dvarim, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, after we finish each book, in Shul, in the synagogue on Shabbos, after we finish the last portion in that book, we say Chazak, Chazak, V'nischazek. The origin of this minhag, of this custom is, it dates back very, very early in Jewish history, right after Moshe Rabbeinu, right after Moses passed away in the desert, as the Jews were about to enter the land of Israel. So the leader that took over Moshe's position was Yehoshua, Joshua. Now, we have the Torah in the written Torah, which is the Tanakh. Tanakh is an acronym for Torah Nevi'im Chesuvim. The first book of the prophets, which are the Torah, the prophets, and the scriptures, the first book of the prophets, the first book in the written Torah to follow the five books of Moses, is the book of Yehoshua, of Joshua. Because Yehoshua was really the foremost student of Moshe. He was Moshe's foremost student, and he, as the one who received the most from Moshe, was the one who took over Moshe's leadership role after Moshe passed away. So at the very, very beginning of the book of Yeshua, the beginning of the book of Joshua, right when he was, before he even started his position, literally immediately following the passing of Moshe Rabbeinu, Hashem says to him, Rak Chazak Ve'ematz, you have to be strong. You have to really hold a strong, steadfast position. Lishmer lasos kachal haTorah asher tzivcha Moshe. Lishmer, to protect, lasos, to do, to act upon, all the Torah that Moshe taught you. Now, the reason that this was an important time for Hashem to tell him this was because Yehoshua had learned from Moshe Rabbeinu. He had dedicated his life to studying and being the most dedicated student that Moshe Rabbeinu had. But studying is one thing. Having to then stand up and be an ambassador of the Torah, lishmer lasos, to do, to not just know what it says in Torah, but to personify that, to represent it, takes a lot of strength. That's not so simple. And now that Yehoshua was transitioning from the role of student, someone who was studying, and as all of you here are very well aware, studying is also not so easy. To sit and learn Torah all day is very demanding. It's very draining. It takes a lot of effort. It's not a simple thing to do. But to then get out there and to live up to that, to get out in the world and be able to stand strong and to personify Torah, to be an ambassador and representative of the Torah out in the world to the level that was required of Yehoshua as the leader of the Jewish people, is a very big ask. It's not an easy thing to do. So Hashem said to him, Chazak ve'ematz, you've got to be strong now. Lishma lasos kechol haTorah she'etzivcha Moshe. Now that you have to do, now that you have to exemplify everything that's in the Torah that Moshe taught you, Torah she'etzivcha Moshe, which Moshe taught you, Moshe commanded you, now you've got to really be strong. So Hashem was telling Yehoshua, now that you have concluded your period of study, your stage as a student and you're moving on to the stage of having to live this, to personify it, to represent it out in the world, you're going to need to be strong. Now, when Hashem says something, when Hashem gives an instruction, gives a directive, it's not just an instruction. When Hashem never demands anything of us that we're not capable of doing. So when Hashem instructs us to do something, that by definition gives us the ability to do it. So Hashem was number one instructing / advising Yehoshua. He was letting him know, by the way, you're going to have to be really strong now. But by telling him that, that actually gave him the ability to do it. So it was both a encouragement as well as a blessing that he would have the ability to be strong as required. When we finish reading one of the books of the Torah, one of the five books of the Torah, Chamishol Chumshei Torah in Shul, we say the same thing. And that's where it comes from, that word chazak. He said, chazak ve'ematz, you've got to be strong. We say chazak, chazak v'nis chazak. We have now concluded the official study of the book of Bereishis, the book of Genesis, for this cycle, for this calendar year. And we know that it's not just about study for the sake of study. Torah study is an extremely academic activity, an extremely academically rewarding activity and pursuit. But it's not just purely about the academia. Torah study is to enable us to live lives that are in line with what Torah teaches us. So now that we've finished learning the book of Bereishis, we read the last Torah portion of Bereishis in Shul, we say to ourselves and to each other in Shul, Chazak, Chazak, v'nischazik. Now we've got to be strong. We finished studying. It's not just about study. Now that we've done the learning, the reading, the studying, we've got to stand up and exemplify everything we learn. We've got to live that. We've got to personify that. That takes strength. So we encourage ourselves and each other and bless ourselves and each other that we should have the strength to do that. So what we're effectively doing when we say chazak, chazak, v'nischazik is really reinforcing in a practical way the message of everything we just got out of the Torah in the study of this book of Bereishis, the book of Genesis. Now there's a concept in halacha that says hakol hulech achar hachitum. Chitum comes from the Hebrew word chosam, conclusion. Everything goes after the conclusion. Now, halachically, the context in which this statement is generally applied is that the bracha of Me'ein Sholesh, which we say, it's called Me'ein Sholesh because there are three different versions. We say it after eating from the fruits with which the land of Israel is blessed. We say it after drinking wine. We say it after mezonos, after foods that are made out of the five grains with which halachic bread, bread that's classified halachically as bread, is made. If it's not bread, but it's still a staple sustaining food, we make the blessing afterwards of Ala Micha. Now in this blessing, so the body of the blessing is the same, and there's a little space near the beginning and near the end where we insert one of three options depending on what we just ate, whether we ate food that's mezonos, sustaining food from these five grains, which is not bread, wine, or the fruits with which the land of Israel is blessed. Now, we insert that at the beginning, at the end. Now, let's say that I just drank wine, but instead of making the blessing after wine, I say, Ala Michya. I'm absent-minded, I spaced out, I quickly say it, and I say Ala Michya more frequently than I say Ala Geffen. Which may or may not be a good thing, whatever. But that's subjective, I suppose. But, so I drink wine, and now I need, or grape juice, whatever it is. They're both halachically, technically classified as wine as far as this and other halachas are concerned. Now I'm supposed to make the blessing after wine and I accidentally make the bracha ala michya. Do I have to make the blessing again? And the answer is yes, I do. Now things get more complicated. What if I say the correct phrase at the beginning and the incorrect one at the end, or vice versa? Is it okay if I have one out of two? Is it not okay if I have one out of two that's wrong? And the answer is it depends. Hakol hulach achar hachitum. It goes by the conclusion. If I make the correct selection at the end of the blessing, I say the concluding phrase for wine, even though I said ala michya at the beginning, it's okay because it goes by the conclusion. And this isn't just some random mystical thing that was picked out of a hat because we had to decide what to do. It makes a lot of sense. Anybody in here who's studied language, even at the high school level, if you've ever had to write a composition for language, you know that one of the things that has the highest concentration of marks attributed to it when you're getting marked on an essay is the conclusion. And there's a very good reason. Because the conclusion is the thing that the reader is walking away with. That's the thing that's going to be lingering in their gut when they walk away from reading your composition. So that's the thing that, to an extent, is the most important. Now, the opening, the introduction is also very important, and you'll, you know, there's a lot of marks, a relatively high concentration of marks usually associated with the introduction and the opening paragraph. Practically speaking, I would argue that that's more of a functional thing rather than having to do with the overall impact of your essay. Because the fact is, when your teacher marks your essay in school, they have to read to the end. So the fact that I wrote a very poor introduction isn't going to stop the teacher from reading to the end, because that's their job and they're getting paid to do it. So all they're going to do is say -3 marks for writing a poor introduction. But if I do that in a blog post and you're scrolling through Facebook or Instagram and the opening line is really poor and unengaging and not interesting, you're scrolling right through to the next thing. You're never going to get to even read what I wrote. So the introduction is very important, because the introduction has to be engaging to get you to continue reading. But at the end of the day, in terms of the overall impact of this piece of writing, the thing, as long as I can get you to keep reading and get you to go to the end, the thing that's going to leave the strongest impact, the thing that you're going to walk away remembering the most, assuming that all parts of this composition were written equally effectively, the thing that's going to walk away with you together the most is the conclusion. That's the last thing you read. That's going to leave the most strongly lasting impression. So when you're writing something, make sure that the opening is good enough to keep people reading. But when you get to the end, look over that concluding paragraph and that concluding sentence again and again and again to make sure that the point is clear, to make sure that it's powerful, to make sure that it's emotive. So when the person walks away, they still have that lingering, because hakol holach achar hachitum. Everything that this person is going to walk away with is going to be focused on and revolving around the conclusion. So, let's look at the concluding pasuk of the book of Bereishis, which we just finished reading on Shabbos. The concluding verse is, Yomas Yosef ben Mea ve'eser shanim. Yosef passed away at the age of 110. Ve'yachan to'ose, and they embalmed him. Ve'yisem ba'aron be'mitzrayim, and he was placed in a coffin in Egypt. It's not so super exciting. First of all, it's not so exciting that Yosef died. Second of all, it's not so exciting that he was buried in Egypt. You think he wanted to be buried in Egypt? Before, remember, his father Yaakov, just very recently, went, before he passed away, his parting words, or the second last thing that he said basically, was to Yosef. He said, promise me, swear to me, make an oath that when I pass away, you will take me out of Egypt and take me straight to Israel. I don't want to be in Egypt. And as soon as the 70-day period, which was 40 days of the embalming process and 30 days of mourning, as soon as those 70 days were over, Yosef upped and took him out back to Israel. Yaakov didn't want to be in Egypt. Yosef got stuck there for a very long time. You think he was excited about it? Is that something exciting? It's like, yeah, the conclusion of Sefer Bereishis is Yosef died and he was buried in Egypt. Chazak, chazak, v'nischazek, awesome, yeah, let's reinforce that. What is it about this verse, Yosef died and was buried in Egypt? I could think of a lot of hashtags that would probably, apparently, be more appropriate for that pasuk than chazak, chazak, v'nischazek. So, what's with this proximity? Why is it that this pasuk is chosen as the grand finale, the concluding sentence of the entire book of Genesis? Yosef died and was buried in Mitzrayim. Chazak, chazak, v'nischazek. Let's reinforce that, yeah. Now, obviously, there's a reason. The question is, what is it? So, if we have to draw a contrast or define as a whole, what's the overall message, the overall content of the book of Genesis, the book of Bereishis, as opposed to how the book of Shemos opens up and continues forward? Basically, what's happening here is the concluding verse of the book of Genesis, book of Bereishis, was Yosef passed away. As long as Yosef was alive, his family was protected from slavery. Effectively, as soon as he passed away, the onslaught, the persecution began. So the book of Bereishis, the book of Genesis, is really essentially the preparation and lead up to the slavery and persecution in Egypt. Now, some of you, or all of you, may be thinking, whoa, 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 easy, Tiger. That seems like a little bit of an extremely overarching generalization. Like, yeah, the last 2, 3, 4, 5 Torah portions. The whole book of Genesis is the preparation and lead up to the slavery in Egypt. 7 days, 6 days of creation in Shabbos. Cain and Hevel, Cain and Abel, the generation of Noach and the flood, the Dor HaFlogah, the generation that built the tower, which is the next thing we read about after Noach, Lot, all of that is classified as, it's defined as part of the lead up to the exile and slavery in Egypt. Seems a little bit of an overarching generalization, but it's not. And what this comes back to is my favorite question. Who knows what's my favorite question? What's the question I ask the most frequently in class? What is the reason that the universe was created? What is the reason for which the universe was created, right? I've asked that once or twice. The reason, and really I want to focus on two reasons, because there are a number of reasons, all of which come from Torah, and they're not mutually exclusive. There are more than one motivation. There is more than one motivation that the Creator has for creating the world. One is, and this is the one we focused on the most in Chassidus, because it's the one that's most practically relevant to us and our mission and our job here, our responsibilities. And that is, as it says in the Medrash Tanchum, the Creator wanted to have a dwelling place in the physical world. The Creator wanted us to bring divinity, spirituality, godliness into the fabric, the experiences of the physical universe, which is a physical and spiritual impossibility. Spirituality does not physically exist. It exists. It's equally as real as the physical world is, but it doesn't physically exist. If you look at the rules that define, the parameters that define physical existence, angels don't fit into that. Angels don't physically exist. Godliness doesn't physically exist. Spirituality, all the things we talk about that are spiritual, they don't physically exist. That doesn't mean they're any less real. It's just a different reality. It's a different graph altogether. They're not even on the same chart. And the same is true in reverse. As far as the spiritual is concerned, the physical universe doesn't exist because it's not spiritual. Based on the parameters that define spirituality, the physical universe doesn't exist. So they are both equally real, but they don't exist each as far as the other is concerned. So how are we supposed to unite two things that don't even exist in the same reality? They're not measured based on the same parameters. How does that work? That works because, and as I give the analogy probably almost every week lately, of the court translator. You have a court in Brooklyn, you have a person who speaks Croatian, Vietnamese, Mandarin, it doesn't really make a difference what it is, Russian, Hebrew, speaks a language that's not English and doesn't speak a word of English, and the judge and jury don't speak a word of the language this person speaks. You have to have someone who can understand and speak both languages proficiently so that they can then facilitate communication between the two. We, as people, have something very special that even angels don't. Angels are spiritual. They are very spiritually advanced, very spiritually evolved. They are spiritually in touch. But they can't bring any of that into this world because they don't physically exist. They can't interact with, they can't engage with the physical world. How are we supposed to bring godliness into this world? We have a body and a soul. We speak both languages. We are the interpreter. We are the facilitators of communication between physical and spiritual. The question is, how does that even work? How can we have a body and a soul? Because for us to have a body and a soul is equivalent of matter and spirit coming together. It should be impossible, and it is impossible. But the Creator, who is not limited by the parameters that define physical or spiritual, the Creator who created the physical and the spiritual and the parameters that define physical and the parameters that define spiritual and the concept of realities that are mutually exclusive and defined by parameters that don't apply to each other, the Creator who created all of that decided that in a specific instance, he's going to override those rules. And this is something we say in the Bracha of Asher Yotzar. There's a blessing that we say in the morning blessings. It's said after using the bathroom. And at the conclusion, we say, we thank, bless Hashem, Rofe Kol Basar, who heals all flesh, or Mafli Lasos, and does wonders. One of the wonders that we refer to is that the Creator overrides the nature of the physical universe and the nature of spirituality in allowing body and soul to come together in a person. That is a wonder. Once the Creator has done that and given us the opportunity to live a life as a person, a Homo sapiens, which is by definition a combination of Homo sapiens body and Homo sapiens soul, human body, human soul, aka person, We have the ability to interact with and engage the physical world. And because we also have a soul that is equally a part of us as our body, we are able to channel spirituality, divinity, godliness through our actions into the world. This is why the world was created, to bring divinity into the physical world, to unite matter and spirit. Another one of the reasons for which the world was created, another fundamental reason, was to give us the opportunity to achieve. To give us the opportunity to become the Creator's partners in creation. When we do something that's not easy, when we stand up to a challenge and do something novel, something that requires an investment of effort and an intentional decision to go against the grain, we're doing something novel, we're doing something new. If we do something that's really new, that is, in effect, an act of creation. It's doing something, making something that wasn't there before. The Creator created a world that was not entirely complete, not entirely perfect, and left us the job, which is both a responsibility and a privilege, to finish that up, to add the finishing touches to creation. When we create, we, in effect, become an embodiment of divinity, because creating is something that only God can do. We achieve. When we stand up to challenges, we grow. We achieve. The second reason for which God created the world was to give us the opportunity to grow, to achieve, and to, in a sense, actually become divine. These two are two of, if not the two primary reasons for which the universe was created. Now, when I say the universe, I don't mean just the physical universe, all of the spiritual realities, the angels, everything except for God itself, everything outside of God, everything else was created intentionally by God, all as part of the realization of both of those purposes. Did someone ask something? No. Okay. Now, Golos, exile, persecution, difficulties, challenges that come with Golos, with exile, are really essential for these purposes to be realized. Because, number one, they expose us to parts of the world that we wouldn't really be engaged with otherwise, which means that we are therefore able to create a Dir B'Tachtonim, a dwelling place for divinity in the material world, to unite matter and spirit completely. Without the Golos, part of that would be missing. And when I say part of that would be missing, it's not just geographical. It's not just like, oh, it was the exile in Egypt and now they were able to bring divinity into Egypt, and if not for that, they wouldn't have brought it into Egypt. Because they could have not had the exile in Egypt, and some of them could have just chosen to live there and lived a good life following the guidelines of the Torah in Egypt and then brought divinity into Egypt. When I say parts of the world, I don't just mean geographical parts of the world. It means elements of the world which are not just objects or places. There are abilities we have to do things. We have gifts, we have talents. We have the ability to weigh things up and make decisions. Now, when I say an ability is not just some sort of abstract, intangible thing. Every ability that we have to do something, whether it's physical, whether it's cognitive, I'm able to move my phone, I'm able to talk, I'm able to think, to an extent at least, I'm able to make decisions. Those abilities that I have are the result of different parts of my brain that have been designed and created to carry those functions out. When we weigh up options to make a decision, you could actually measure that. If we were plugged into the right sort of sensory equipment, you would actually be able to see the activity in our brains and see exactly which part of our brains are being activated by this thought process. When we want to move, if I make a decision to move something, you can see in various parts of my brain. You'll first see activity in the part of my brain that is planning the movement. You'll then see activity in the parts of the brain that coordinate the movement, and activity in the parts of the brain that are responsible for actually activating the movement. So when I say abilities, it's not just abstract. It's tangible. It's physical parts of the brain. It's the nerves that are involved. It's the muscles that are involved. When I use my decision-making ability as part of my service to the Creator, as part of my mission here to uplift the world, I have brought divinity into my decision-making ability. I have made those parts of my brain that are involved in processing and making a decision, I've made them divine. The concept of decision-making has been elevated and has become more divine, I've strengthened its connection with divinity. Every part of me that's been involved in the process has become divine. When we are in a state of persecution, we're supposed to be finished already. Is there something immediately following this? Can I continue for like 10 minutes? What's that? Okay. I don't want to get in trouble with him. My wife might get really angry, but I kept her father waiting. Yeah, that's true. Fair point. You really had to ruin my joke, right? Okay. Anyways, so every time, so Golos Exile, I'm going to have to really accelerate this because we're like a third of the way through, again for change as usual, gives us the opportunities to elevate additional parts of the world, the ability, that part of us that processes and stands up to challenges, overcomes challenges, decides to stand up to those challenges. All those parts of us wouldn't get activated if we weren't facing the challenges of persecution, the challenges of exile. So exile is intrinsically essential to the purpose of creation. So exile was going to happen. Exactly when and where was yet to be decided, but it was going to happen. If you see him, let me know. He's here? Oh boy. Okay, you can calm down. I don't know what... Can I have like 180 seconds? Doesn't hear me. Okay. Basically, exile's intrinsic to creation. Now, an intrinsic to the fundamental to the purpose of creation. If we look at the life that Yosef HaTzadik lived, we see two things. Number one, he wasn't subject to Egypt. He was the boss of Egypt. He ruled Egypt. He stood above Egypt and said, "You're not going to tell me what to do. I'm going to tell you what to do." Number two is that Yosef was deeply involved in the minutia of the management of this superpower at the extremist levels. He was involved in the finest details of the most mundane parts of the world to extreme levels, all the while retaining his connection to spirituality. He was the epitome of what we're here to do, to bring matter and spirit together. Not all of us can get that deeply involved in the world without getting distracted from our purpose and where we come from and why we're here, but he could. So number one, he was the boss of Egypt, the boss of the world. It wasn't the boss of him. Number two, he was able to balance his connection to the material world and to spirituality to an extreme degree. He exemplified these two things that we needed help with while we were going to be in exile. If the book of Bereshit, the book of Genesis, is the lead up to the exile, which begins, the persecution begins at the beginning of the book of Shemos. If the overall message and content of the book of Bereshit, the book of Genesis, is the lead up to exile, what's the concluding phrase of that preparation? The concluding, the grand finale of the entire months during which we've been reading about the lead up and preparation to the exile in Egypt is the words, "He was buried in Egypt." Yosef exemplified the ability to stay above challenges and not get knocked down by them. He exemplified the ability to balance, to interact with matter and spirit in a healthy, balanced way and bring them together. He was buried in Egypt to make sure that he would be there with us, and while we were there, he would help us manage that. And that's why this is the conclusion of the book. You're about to go into exile. We're finishing the lead up. No, Yosef is buried in Egypt with you. He's there with you. He is going to be there as a blessing to continue to reinforce your ability to manage these things effectively. And this is why on those words we say Chazak, Chazak, v'nischazek. And this applies to us today as well. We are in exile. We're in Golos. We're waiting for Mashiach. We're waiting for redemption. We're waiting for Geula. While we're here waiting, we have to know, and we said this on Shabbos, Vayisem ba'aren b'mitzrayim, Hashem made sure that the Jews in Egypt had the blessings, had the resources that they needed to get the job done and to pull through, to make it out on the other side. We have that as well today. And on those words, Vayisem ba'aren b'mitzrayim, he was buried in Egypt, we said Chazak, Chazak v'nischazek. Yes, we do want to reinforce the message of those words that when we're in exile, we have everything we need. to survive, to stay above it, and to get the job done. And that's why, deliberately, specifically on those words, we say chazak, chazak, v'nischazek, and that's the decision for the words with which the entire book of Shemos concludes, because that's the most important message with which we need to walk away.
Wow.
Boom.
Boom.